This is the third story in our series on where artificial intelligence is already making a difference. Last week, it was teachers using AI in the classroom. This week, it's the effect it's having on the huge bureaucracy that is the U.S. military, where it's not so much what is already deployed as it is changing the entire theory of warfare and how to prepare for it.
The future of war is going to come when you take that very large quantity of vehicles and robotic systems and marry it with an intelligence that can see, think, and act on the battlefield.
It's really about a changing nature of warfare where we're looking at how to incorporate autonomy into all kinds of different operations.
Warfare is going to be fought with a mixture of kind of a human and a machine.
The U.S. military has long put a premium on avoiding mistakes at all costs. But with artificial intelligence, the government might need to take a page out of Mark Zuckerberg's playbook. Move fast and break things if it's going to keep up with technological change.
We as an army have done an incredibly poor job over the last three or four decades of just saying, hey, if you have an idea that we think could be powerful for soldiers, get it to us as quickly as possible.
The Secretary of the U.S. Army, Dan Driscoll, is the point person for getting the Pentagon to take a whole new approach, driven in large part by AI.
The way that we used to acquire things as an army is we'd have 16 steps that a thing would have to go through before we wrote a check, and any of the stops along those 16 could send it back to the beginning, and with the incentive structure where saying yes was punished and saying no was rewarded, most times it would end up in this doom loop of kind of forever decision making, and we are collapsing all of that down. So everyone will report directly to the Chief of Staff of the Army and I, and we will hold them accountable for going very quickly and testing new things and learning.
Former U.S. Department of Defense Deputy Secretary Kathleen Hicks agrees that these changes are essential, but she also warns that they're not easy. To what extent is there resistance in the Pentagon for really making the changes that AI may require?
Culture change overall, I think, is really our biggest challenge. And it isn't just in the Pentagon. It's all across the stakeholders on Capitol Hill, throughout industry. There are a lot of invested incentives in doing things the way they've always been done. But AI is being used, especially away from the battlefield, in terms of bringing in lots of data and then using AI to quickly sift through that data and make sense of it. So if you think back, for example, to the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, where Americans faced challenges around IEDs, these explosive devices that were often buried in the earth, you can imagine how AI is already being used to look at pictures visually, to understand different data that's coming in. We really are just at the beginning of that maturation cycle where you could imagine different autonomous systems. I think that is the next frontier.
Ryan Tseng is the president and co-founder of one of the companies hoping to drive the change in the U.S. defense posture. Shield AI is an aerospace and technology company moving at breakneck speed to develop the AI-powered drones Secretary Driscoll says he needs.
For the last 20 years, adversaries have modernized and enhanced their defense capabilities or their warfighting capabilities. And our ability to deter conflict in the future depends on the adoption of new technologies to make our warfighters more effective, and chief among them is AI and autonomy.
What does AI make available that otherwise you would not have from other technology?
I think the most fundamental thing that it does is it enables the deployment of effective mass on the battlefield. You can see in Ukraine millions upon millions of drones and missiles being produced, but they're limited in their ability to see, think, and act based on what's going on in the battlefield. They might be remote controlled by a very focused operator who's connected to them via fiber optic cable. But this huge volume of robotic systems, whether they're drones, land vehicles, or boats, or undersea vehicles, don't have their own ability to see, think, and act on the battlefield, and then therefore their effectiveness is limited. The future of war is going to come when you take that very large quantity of vehicles and robotic systems and marry it with an intelligence that can see, think, and act on the battlefield so that it is effective.
If you think of having to defend against a swarm of 1,000 incoming drones, a human brain is not capable of pulling off that decision-making at that scale and the speed required. it's a really complex problem that just human beings are not well suited to answer on their own. And then if you think that you're in a wartime area and your enemy has those types of defensive capabilities that are run by artificial intelligence, it's going to be really hard for a human being to plan an attack in that space. And so in a lot of ways, what part of warfare may look like is artificial intelligence driven drone on drone fighting may be the new future of the front line for a while.
As Secretary Driscoll and his colleagues at the Pentagon spur the organization to develop high-tech weaponry for the future, they're watching it get deployed right now in Ukraine.
Ukraine is considered by many to be the Silicon Valley of war. We are hoping to repeat those lessons learned through our processes and our systems here. But what we do know is drone warfare is completely upending and altering how wars have been fought and how people have thought about fighting. We have got to get to a place where we can update things quickly. I was just a couple of weeks ago at a base and looking at one of our kind of air and missile defense systems, and the laptop that was running this system was 30 plus years old. This soldier using it was 22. So this computer he is trying to use is 8 years older than the soldier. You have to be able to update things within 2 weeks. And so it is not just a failed system, it is a sinfully failed system.
There's been a lot of work from the U.S. military side with Ukrainians. Also, our NATO allies work closely with the Ukrainians. The Brits, for example, are very engaged in learning from what's happening there. The Russians are also learning, and we have seen improvements from them. But I do think we're very engaged looking at what's happening in the Ukraine war and trying to learn our own lessons from it.
It's not just AI and drones that are coming to warfare. It's also new technology like autonomous vehicles, as German AV trucking company Fernride is demonstrating right now in Europe. Hendrik Kramer is the CEO.
So right now we have this pressure cooker moment in Europe where the geopolitical situation and the war in Ukraine and the potential conflict of NATO in Europe with Russia is leading to a huge demand for unmanned systems and ground autonomy. Unlike the drone systems in the air, it has not been deployed and developed. Therefore, I think the impact will be broadly in defense and also civil logistics. So one of the most important defense application is very similar to a hub-to-hub autonomous trucking product where you are, for example, having a coupling bridge between Poland and Lithuania where Belarus and Russia are having this very small gap to connect the Baltic states with Poland and mainland NATO countries. And I think this is one of the applications where it will be very dangerous to put people into trucks on public roads. And therefore, this is a fantastic application where the same technology that is working for civil or defense or vice versa can be developed and scaled right now.
It's one thing to see the future, it's another to move aggressively to reach it. And Shield AI's Ryan Tseng says there's still work to be done.
If that is the future of war, how much of it is in the present? How much is AI already being used in combat situations?
It's being used selectively today. It's not deployed at very large scale. And I think a lot of that is just the friction that exists between defense departments globally and in industry. If you look around the United States, I guess specifically, there's so many examples of industry moving out at light speed. And our own defense department has shown its capability to mobilize at light speed. But there has been a lot of friction in the acquisition system that slows down the government-industry partnership. And I think that has been responsible for slowing down the adoption of AI, despite many of the capabilities existing today and being battlefield ready today.
As promising as AI is in giving the United States new warfighting capabilities, it is not a replacement for the soldier any more than it can be for your doctor or your teacher.
We're going to need everyone. It's all hands on deck, as I used to say at DoD. We need our traditional defense manufacturers, particularly for the scale of manufacturing that we require, for their knowledge and deep expertise. And we need that innovation that's coming all across the sector, but particularly from the startup community. And at the end of the day, warfare has to remain a human act of judgment. But AI can really help bring speed and precision to all kinds of aspects of military operations.